Well, hi and welcome everyone to this online international symposium, which is titled Radical Domesticities. It's great to see so many of you streaming in the last few minutes and joining us here at the University of Newcastle. My name's Jasper Ludwig. I'm a lecturer here in the School of Architecture and Built Environment, and it's a great pleasure for me to be acting as the chair of this very interesting, I think, event today. I'll get to the event itself and the broader context in which it sits very shortly, and I think you'll probably only need to endure me for about 5 minutes or so. But first, I'd like to begin by acknowledging that this symposium, or at least most of it, is taking place on Aboriginal land, on the country of the Pambalong people of the Awabakal Nation. And I'd like to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. As I say, it's a great pleasure to be able to bring you this event today, which has been quite a while in the making, and to do so alongside our three keynote speakers whose locations, whose distribution across the globe sketches out, I think, a truly international geography for a one-day symposium, unlike any I've ever been involved in the past. We're going to be hearing from Gretchen Wilkins, Head of Architecture at the Cranbrook Academy of Art, who is our first speaker this Australian morning, and who's based in Detroit in the United States. We'll hear from Philippe De Ferrari, who's co-founder of Plan Commune, based in Paris, and who's going to be speaking later this evening, Australian time. And we're going to be hearing from Jack Self, who's founding director of The Real Foundation and editor-in-chief of The Real Review, who's going to follow on from Philippe later on this evening, and who's based in London. All three of these guests who you see here in this slide are visiting architects at the University of Newcastle this semester. And their contributions today to this particular symposium, as well as to our programs more broadly, our teaching, forms part of a new initiative, an initiative that we're experimenting with this semester in our school. Don't waste a good crisis, as I'm sure you've heard being said recently. This experiment is to try to structure the delivery of our teaching across our design studios and across our architecture courses and across our programs more broadly around a common thematic, around a common set of concerns and questions that we're encouraging all of our students across all year groups to consider from week to week in some way in their work. And the thematic for this semester is titled Radical Work, which you're able to read more about on our dedicated website, which you can see here, but which broadly speaking opens our teaching and the work of our students up to questions of radicality, of how to identify and articulate what radicality is, both in this particular historical curious moment and in architecture as a discipline more generally. We've also programmed a series of other events like this one this semester, which run in concert with what we're doing here today, some of which have already taken place and can be found on our website, which I'm showing you here, and some of which are still to come. So I suppose I also want to take this opportunity to invite you all to see what else we're up to in Newcastle this semester, and to invite you to tune into anything that catches your eye on our website. And it's also just in this respect that I want to give a special mention to Professor Pia Edney-Brown, who has tirelessly coordinated and facilitated what we're doing this semester in this program, and has made today's events possible. So part of our engagement with the idea of radicality so far, with this theme that we've set for ourselves, has been to view radicality as simultaneously both a diagnostic and a prescriptive, as both a mode of interrogation and a mode of action. And to be radical effectively means to go to the roots of something, to contemplate a practice or a method, an analysis, a line of inquiry, all the way to its foundations, perhaps in order to change those foundations, but not always necessarily or immediately. So in effect, radicality means to consider and clarify the root causes of things. And it's in keeping with this sort of bracketed sense of radicality that this symposium, Radical Domesticities, approaches its subject. Because unlike anything else in living memory, a virus has made us hyper aware of the fundamental spatial and political conditions of our everyday lives. It has, in a sense, radicalized everyday life. And it's done this by clarifying the variety of ways in which we're defined and managed as individuals, at the scale of the nation state and the closure of its international borders, at the scale of the state and the control of its domestic borders, at the scale of the suburb or the postcode, at the scale of the individual household, even at the scale of the individual body and its permissible proximity to other bodies. And so it's in these ways that an invisible virus has kind of revealed the otherwise equally invisible architectures of everyday life. We've asked our speakers today in this symposium to consider what else in their view now seems altered in terms of how we inhabit home and how we inhabit city, what projects and their premises still hold for architectural thought and architectural practice, which histories now speak to us in more immediate terms, and which questions should we be asking or returning to perhaps in this moment. I'm personally really looking forward to seeing how each of our speakers responds, the first of whom, as I mentioned, is Gretchen Wilkins. Gretchen has taught architecture in the United States, in Australia and Vietnam, and before taking up her current position at the Cranbrook Academy of Art as head of architecture, she was professor at the University of Michigan and associate professor at RMIT in Melbourne. Her work, broadly speaking, considers the making and crucially also the unmaking of cities through design, through manufacturing and mobility, and she was editor of the volume Distributed Urbanism, Cities After Google Earth, which is really interesting if you haven't read it already. We consider ourselves really lucky to have Gretchen as one of our visiting architects this semester, and if we could be in the same room together, I'd ask you to join me in a round of welcoming applause. So welcome, Gretchen, and thanks for being here.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Jesper, and thanks, Pia. Let me share my screen. There we go. Okay, that was a really nice introduction. I really like the idea of root causes of things, because that may overlap a bit too with what I'm going to talk about tonight or this morning. I titled the talk Domestic Metrics because in thinking about the title and this topic and series that you've set out, which I think is really, really fascinating and really obviously really relevant, and there's multiple ways of thinking about it. For me, it came down to how much of our life now is quantified. Everything from... Hold on. So everything from, sorry, I'm just having trouble with that. It doesn't seem to be advancing, but we'll see. Everything from time, distance, mobility, recreation, work, how much time we can spend in a certain space, when figuring out our studios this semester at Cranbrook, we just went back into our semester, and in certain spaces the students are here, but we're doing a sort of hybrid of online and in-person face-to-face teaching. And so there's all these different metrics around, depending on the crit space you're using, you can have 3 or 4 people for 15 minutes or 2 people for 30 minutes, depending on not just the quantity of space, but also the ventilation, obviously, and the systems of the building and things like recreation, whether you can, I was talking to some friends in Melbourne the other day, and some of the, like whether you can be outside as 1 person or 2 people for 1 hour. In the UK, you have to walk your dog for 2 hours, right? Like all of these things are now completely metricized and quantified. And I think, the series has started out, all of that comes to converge in the house, in the single family house. I'm going to see if I can advance this now. Sorry, it's just not going forward.
Can you click those arrows, Gretchen?
Yes, that would work. Thank you. Okay. All right, so we're back on. All of this comes into the house, right? So everything that we're doing now that we used to be obviously distributed around series of spaces and public spaces and work and in the world is now all in where we're living. And so, you know, radical domesticity, this is a kind of moment where we're thinking a lot about how do we parse that out? How do you manage that? What are the boundaries around these various activities that we're now have all within one space and within, you know, sometimes 1 family or 2 families or however far that bubble, you know, expands in each person's world. So I guess for me I started thinking about domestic space and it's something that I've have been thinking about for quite a long time, even back to my master's thesis, which I'll show a couple slides of, because I think it's part of this discussion around how we measure and value space, how we think about domestic space in terms of the root causes, in fact, in terms of the metrics that from which it originates. And in the other way, I suppose, and this gets to these slides, is how do we think about it as even a plan? What is inscribed into the plans of a house plan? And I like to go back to Robin Evans. These are pages from his book called, the essay in Translations from Drawing to Building, but this is from Figures, Doors, and Passages. He looks at these different examples of 16th century houses, a villa in Italy, and the Amesbury House in England, for exactly that, for how you can see social inscription in the plan of the building itself. I'm just gonna hide that so I can read it. So on the left is a series of rooms on facade. So each, you have to go through one room to get to another. There's no corridor, there's no separate circulation space that you can sort of retreat to and go to each room, as opposed to the example on the right, where there is this introduction of passage. And even beyond that, there's, as you can see, two stairways, right? The central stair and then the probably more public and grand stair, which always was meant to separate out different groups living there, usually the servants from the family. And he talks a lot about this, the not just the difference in social interaction, but the sort of cultural aspects behind that, through, say, the quote on the top where he says, the fondness for company, proximity, an incident in 16th century Italy corresponded nicely enough with the format of the architectural plans. But then in the English example, from the architect's point of view, all occupants of a house, whatever their social standing, had become nothing but a potential source of irritation to each other. So I think this kind of question around how much do we want to be this sort of convergence? And is there a tipping point? Is there a kind of saturation point where in the house, we're actually trying to look for ways of revamping distance and boundary or not. And that's all, you know, that's quite a, I guess, a personal thing. These are also examples from figure stories and passages. The example of the quote, functional house for frictionless living by Alexander Klein, where he gives the example of two house plans. Again, one, the bad example is the one where there's a lot of interaction and overlap. And the good example is one where all of those sort of pathways are parsed out, are separated out, so that there's less friction. The justification for Klein's plan was the metaphor hidden in its title, which implied that all accidental encounters caused friction and therefore threatened the smooth running of the domestic machine, a delicately balanced and sensitive device it was too, always on the edge of malfunction. So that reminded me, going back a little bit further to Christine Frederick and questions of Taylorism and then in the case, you know, my background in currently being in Detroit Fordism, scientific management, right? Like this idea that you take the principles of efficient planning into the domestic sphere as a way of trying to resolve, say, friction or trying to resolve the inefficiencies that are brought about by potentially too much interference in any one task. I think these are really, I guess, interesting examples because just in general, but because of the time we find ourselves in and thinking about other examples, other models of that. For example, this, the Mobius House by UN Studio from the late 90s, just turning any of those principles on their head, right? Where in this case, the whole point actually is the house as a 24-hour cycle of working and living, working and living, sleeping, working, living, sleeping. And as you've, you know, I'm sure you've seen in the various photos of the interior of the house, those things start to get knitted together in a very integrated way. So I think that for me, the talk today, that as an introduction, most of it maybe isn't directly about the pandemic and COVID, but looking at domestic space in terms of these underlying metrics or these underlying sort of root causes, what can we understand about the domestic space by looking closely at the way in which it was made or the context in which it emerged. Coming from the US, and this was something I looked at quite a lot, I think it was like 20 years ago when I was doing my master's thesis, is the proliferation post-war, mainly post-World War II, proliferation of housing, of suburban tract housing in the US. This is the, you know, this is the model. This is the majority of housing in anywhere that's not in a dense city. And I will talk first a bit about the house and then talk a bit about the urban scale in the later part of this. So, but starting with, because these relate, right? Like the whole idea of mass-produced housing in the US, which does come out of the technologies and again, efficiencies and means of industrial production that followed World War II, when there was a boom in housing and the demand for housing. But there were also all of these technologies that were coming out of the war effort that now could be applied and were applied to any number of other industries, housing being the one that was the most pressured at the moment. So plywood, for example, using it, and the Eames did this, which I'll show, but using plywood and the malleability of plywood and lightness of plywood now for other purposes. And there were so many examples of this, of retooling industry from a military complex into a housing industrial complex. As Robert Friedel wrote, by looking at the ways in which Americans' dreams of their domestic future intersected with the enormous forces of war and statecraft, we can catch a glimpse of how the transformation of life grew out of the ungodly mix of war, economics, and technology. So, this is kind of the, you know, the ubiquity of housing in the US, of suburban housing in the US, coming out of this, the efficiencies of production. So tract housing, laying out tract housing, the Levitt brothers in Levittowns around the country were our direct export of this, but it not is in the case of all, I suppose, not just Levittown, in the case of all of these kinds of housing, it's not just the house and the urban implication that's of interest. It's this, again, the social context, or the social condition that was sort of came out of it. And that's very well, I think, represented in the image on the right with the mom talking to a neighbor with the kids. Like it was very much about producing not just housing, but producing a social context around it. Not unlike, as we saw in the examples that Robin Evans was pointing out in the Italian villa in the English manor house. So these are, I think, experiments. All of these are housing experiments that we're still, the house has, I think, always been an experiment, a place of experimentation for domestic life, right? And in this case, I think how it moved from an industrial question around materials and manufacturing and processes and techniques into housing wasn't without that. It's even, you know, even if you boil it down to that, it wasn't without a sort of social agenda, an obvious social agenda behind it. But these are just some more examples of that. So, and the sort of propaganda around using that kind of spirit of the war effort now to house the country's citizens. I mean, it's all a very strong narrative. And architects, a lot of architects got involved with this. Quonset huts now into housing. The Lustron house, which is a 100% metal, sheet metal house, the kit, sort of kit of parts of mass production of that. Volte aircraft, these were house panels by Henry Dreyfuss and Edward Larrabee Barnes, looking at using that manufacturing technique and site, the factories themselves, to make wall panels. That one wasn't as successful. Plastics, plexiglass from the aircraft factory into, again, the dream suite or a domestic application. And, you know, of course, Buckminster Fuller and the Dimaxian House prototype from sort of a, you know, Quonset hut type of building type into now the use of as a house. There was a, from that, this idea of populux was taking it, I suppose, into the interior and into mass consumerism that followed in the wake of this mass production of housing, which is to this combination of popular luxury, where if the outside is sort of standardized, then the interior could be completely customized through color, through material, through patterns. That it's not unlike really how the car model of having a platform and then a series of add-ons into that, options, customizable options. Barbie came around at this time. It was a similar sort of idea of the base model, the unified, universalized body with all of the identities that then could get sort of added onto it. This is sort of the ethos, I guess, of the housing at that time, and something that has been inscribed into housing here as a result. A different tack on that, though, that came out in the 50s, as you know, is the Case Study House program. The competition by Arts and Architecture magazine, 1945, which was looking at this, all these same sort of questions around prefabrication, technology, efficiencies, new materials, new ways of making things, but now asking the question, well, how can, not necessarily we standardize those things, but how can we actually create abundance of options through them? And what will be the result in a social context? Like, what does that mean for the family, what is family and how do we live? So some examples of that I'm sure you're familiar with, like Ralph Rapson's Greenbelt House, Case Study House number 4, where he did these really beautiful drawings of this Greenbelt that moves through the house, sort of blending inside and outside. The very famous Pierre Koningsdahl House in Los Angeles. Most of these houses were in Los Angeles or in that area. Also by Koning, the Bailey House, the integration of the automobile into the house, but using a very modular system, industrialized system. Eichler houses were, those were experiments, and there were lots of suburbs of the Eichler houses that were a similar sort of experiment, but taking it to an urban realm, like actually building subdivisions of, you might say, mid-century modern houses in mostly in the West Coast. And the famous Eames house, Charles and Ray Eames house, house and studio, also looking at a kind of light frame industrial technique, but applied to domestic space. And I think the Eames, just circling back a minute to that transformation of industrial techniques into domestic ones, they were really a central part of that with the plywood experiments that they were working on with the plywood chairs, then starting to work into actually adapt those technologies for things like splints and aircraft components and other efforts for the war. So that practice was, they talked a lot about not necessarily metrics, but constraints, right? This idea of understanding a problem in terms of a design problem in terms of constraints, and then finding a number of solutions around it. So I think they're interesting in the way that they, for them, constraints might be about play or about an affect or about color, because of the wide range of ways in which their work found itself in films, in World Expo buildings, in furniture and textiles and toys. So I think for them, this idea of the making the most for the best for the most for the least is another way of, I think, for me at least, looking at how you understand a problem, like what are the root causes of things? How do you think about design in terms of not necessarily constraints, but working against a kind of the resistances, understanding those resistances, and sort of trying to unfold those. This was something that I was very interested in all the way back to my master's thesis, which this is an image from 20 years ago at the University of Michigan, where I, for whatever strange reason, was fascinated by prisons, and in particular looking at, I volunteered in a women's prison to do arts and educational workshops. And I became really fascinated with some of the arts workshops that were going on, that the range of things that could be made in these incredibly oppressive and sort of awful environments. And so I guess I got interested in, this is this year's, actually they're still running these exhibitions of art by Michigan prisoners. And there was such a lack of resources in any, like emotionally, in terms of the actual materials that someone could work with, because it's so limited and so constricting. And yet you would have these amazingly creative and artistic things coming out of the workshops that we were working on. And I guess I just got interested in how those sorts of things, like how art and creative work can emerge, not only emerge, but in some ways really thrive based on like subverting or expanding beyond the repression, like subverting the rules themselves and being able to find a way of making and imagining things in a world that doesn't otherwise in any possible way support that. So the prison was this example, was one example of that, but I also started looking at even depictions of prison environments, the sort of holistic infinite confinement of an image like Piranesi's series, prison series, of course looking at Bentham and Foucault and Deleuze and the whole sort of series of ways of thinking about how that imprisonment goes from a bodily sense of being being in a space that's confined physically to the panopticon, right, where now you may not even need physical enclosure because it becomes a mental enclosure. And so that, of course, I think some of the interesting examples of also looking at Cool House and this idea of being a voluntary prisoner, this hypothetical project, his thesis project, being a voluntary prisoner of a section of a city and willingly going into a sort of confined space in order to find some other, like in order to benefit some other purpose. In short, for me, it became a lot about my interest moved outside of the prison, the sort of domestic, if you will, space, if you can even call it that, of a prison, into the suburban environment of a suburb in Michigan. And the equivalent, I guess, of the voluntary confinement or voluntary imprisonment in this context for me was the ways in which we become voluntary prisoners, if you will, of a socioeconomic system, a cultural system, a housing system. Suburban restrictive covenants are just one, you know, and probably small, but one example of that, where in most housing tracts, like the ones we were looking at a minute ago, in the suburban housing tracts, there are restrictive covenants. And some of those even have so-called architectural control committees, which dictate what you can and can't do physically on the house and in various activities of the house. And all of it comes down, obviously, to socio-demographic control, to try to, it's a real estate value. It's all about real estate value. So I mapped these, again, this was many years ago, but mapped those, any of the restricted spaces or structures that you might find in a domestic space, and the various subdivision codes, which ones were the most restrictive, which ones were the most lax, what could you do where? And then the project actually, which I don't have images, these are like from old CDs that I had to find images from and find a CD player even to read the CD. But the project was ultimately about mapping these and then finding ways of subverting them. So what are ways you can work within a set of restricted situations in order to find new opportunities for design and for living, and not just, you know, partially it had to do with the form of the house, and partially it had to do with the sort of social constructs that it could enable. This is a project a bit later where it was a similar sort of idea. It was a competition. Actually, the name of the competition was building off of the case study house competition of 1945, but this time looking at some specific places in Cleveland. And our proposal was to take, to do it in at the scale of the house and at the scale of the site. So we had two sites put together, which we then brought together as one site, but tried to find a way in which multiple forms of family could, whatever that meant, could live there and work there. So it was an experiment for us in a way of thinking about more program than just a kind of conventional domestic program in a house, be it work or other sorts of activities that might take place there, but also thinking about how there was some flexibility in the developer model, like in the urban scale, and that this was something you could play out at a larger scale. In the city. So we, as a way of starting, instead of taking for granted the client, which they gave you clients that you could choose, we basically just said, okay, well, what if it could be for any type of family? And we looked at, just as a way of looking at that, we looked at the sitcom families, various sitcom families over the course of, say, 50 years, and found some ones that we all watched when we were, or most of us watched when we were growing up. And mapped a kind of domesticity around these different arrangements. And then used a prefabricated system of these prefab boxes. So there'd be a ground floor that was quite open. And then you could add a series of these sort of loft boxes, crane them on for different types of program as a way of adding more space if you needed to, or adding an office or some sort of public component if you needed to. But it could be either just the first floor, or you could have that, those things could come and go as needed, or as family changed, or as the inhabitants changed. So these were, I guess these examples were things that I've been thinking about from so long ago, and this was an opportunity to rethink them now in terms of how, like, what is the house, and what are the histories of the ways in which we think about the house and how we occupy it. For me, it's always been a kind of elastic scale from the house itself to the city. at the urban scale, I've been living in Melbourne, but then also I lived in Ho Chi Minh City, which this is an image of, for a couple of years, and then spent a lot of time in Detroit. And all of these cities have really interesting relationships between the pattern of what we think of as a house, like whether that's a single family or whether that's multifamily or whether it's an estate housing complex, and the scale of, like, the patterning of the city. In Vietnam, for those of you who've been, there's this really intense sort of pattern of tube houses, very narrow houses that are usually, they can be anywhere from, we had a friend that was doing a 2.5 meter wide tube house that was, I don't know, 4 or 5 stories tall, usually around 10 or 3 or 4 or 5 meters, but super dense, super tightly packed in. And so the pattern of the city starts to get really basically proliferated from that basic sort of, again, root cause or metric of what was originally a French tax law. So under the colonial French rule, they would tax the Vietnamese citizens by the width of the street frontage. So they're very, very narrow for tax reasons, but then would be really deep and really tall. So from that metric, from that financial or economic metric, this whole pattern of the city, you know, emerges more or less over the entire city. But I guess what's interesting is that, you know, so that's a very, that's the historical patterning of the city, very, very dense in District 4, District 1 being kind of like a CBD, so patterns in and out of that and other models. But there is still a lot of development happening in the city, and there's a complete repatterning, potential repatterning of the city in terms of domestic space now through developments like what's happening in the 2TM district, which is a much more dispersed model, a much lower density sort of city garden type of development, which is not unlike when I was spending a lot of time in Tokyo. Similar sort of debates were happening around the historic fabric of the city, how much the city is changing. Again, there is a rapid turnover of building stock in Vietnam at the moment, at least in Ho Chi Minh City, as there was in Tokyo, say in, you know, the late 80s, in a similar kind of repatterning of the city, going from the very dense and pretty sort of homogeneous patterning of density, not a lot, like you might get areas with taller buildings and central business districts, but generally being 3 or 4 or 5 stories and smaller building footprints, to something like, this is an example of Roppongi Hills. That whole section of the city is Roppongi Hills. So it, you know, a city, creating a city within the city with a completely different density pattern to it. And that got me thinking, I suppose, about just density in general in relation to domestic space, like how big is a house? How big does a house need to be? In Japan, there was a lot of discussion around the fact that if even within a micro apartment, a very tiny apartment, the rest of the city becomes your house. Like the social spaces and the eating spaces and work, like all of those things kind of comprise what we now are doing all in our own, you know, small houses. All those things are converging. But in a time now where that becomes difficult, what happens when the house itself is quite small and you can't actually pack all those things into it? So I think this example is from, I'm sure you've seen it, the Antilla house in Mumbai, which is one single family house that's 27 stories, 173 meters tall, 37,000 square meters, has 9 high-speed elevators, 168 car garage, 3 helipads, 50-seat theater, and air traffic control. And this in a city where the average population density is astounding, is 21,000 people per square kilometer. So these disparities, I think, are at the moment really troubling, but maybe interesting for the sake of talking about the unit of domestic space at an urban scale. This was a billboard I saw in Manhattan several years ago, driving on the West Side Highway, and then found Manhattan Mini Storage was actually putting out a lot of these different sort of ads for mini storage, which just seemed to really hit the point about, at least in the US, that there is this, you know, this disparity between domestic space in the city and domestic space in the suburb, like completely different worlds, different, you know, if you leave the city, you'll still have to live in America. You'll still have to live in America. Like it's not, the city isn't America. New York is not Connecticut. And there, I guess there, the idea behind it is, or for me anyway, it picks up on this income disparity and wealth disparity and the accumulation of space in the city around domestic space, right? The accumulation of wealth is an accumulation of space. So when you get these big footprint areas, say in Ho Chi Minh City and Tokyo, all of that is going from, say, let's say, you know, 100 people, or I mean, it's probably like 50,000 people, to maybe two or three owners. And so where you can bring housing back in, the ownership structure is completely different. So the ways in which those interactions, if we go all the way back to the house for frictionless living, or the other example by Robin Evans and the Italian and English houses, like those, the potential for that overlap is now highly controlled, if possible at all. When something like 40% of the world's wealth is owned by 1% of the population, that wealth is space, right? That wealth is the city itself. It's the fabric of the city. Or when 8 of the richest people, who are all men, own as much as 3.6 billion of the poorest. I mean, these metrics are just astounding when you think about it in terms of the urban space of the city, and going from a very fine grain, multiply owned and occupied situation, which is like the bad example of the house for frictionless living times 1,000, right? Which is what cities are, to something that's now the house for frictionless living in a good example, but the entire scale of a city. I mean, that the nature of a city is going to completely change based on the unit of a single domestic space. So I've been interested in ways of, like, how do we resist that? How do we, what are ways of pushing back against that? That momentum of agglomeration of space and frictionless cities, the nail houses in China being, you know, one example, Occupy, of course, being other example. I guess, though, then it kind of, you put the brakes on a minute, because coming back into the discussion around the pandemic and COVID, is density a good thing? Like, can we still have dense cities? Can we still live in a dense way? I've been really curious about the fact that Vietnam, I actually took my students, we as a department went to Ho Chi Minh City in January this year. And it was just starting to, you know, be in the news a lot around Asia. We left at the end of January, got home 1st of February, and felt lucky at the time that we got back and nobody had gotten sick, and we were back and nobody got stuck. And then as it turns out, Vietnam is one of the best, you know, safest and best places to be. The US is now an absolute mess with this. And again, if you look at the US in terms of how we are housed, how people live, it's an individual house buffered by huge amounts of space. And we get in a car and we drive in our space, you know, in our little bubble of a car. We're so parsed out and individualized. And yet the rates of transmission and death in this country are just astounding, where in Vietnam, and you know, in May, now they've had, I think it's around 1,000 cases. But in May and June, it was like a few hundred, I think. And I just thought, like, these are the images that I always look at when I think of Vietnam, and the density, the intensity, the convergence of, like, kids and daycare and families and copper pipes or steel pipes and motorcycles and fish market, like all of these happening in such a tiny amount of space. How is it possible that when something like a pandemic happens, that it's able to be controlled? And I guess it got me thinking about just density in general, because we, you know, these are the kinds of spaces that define everyday life domestically and otherwise. There's really no separation in a lot of cases between domestic life and, say, commercial life in the inner streets and hems of Vietnam. But there's, in the US, and maybe just not in the US, but there's a lot of discussion around density relative now to COVID. And it sort of harkens back to, like, the post-war, the Cold War dispersal of cities, right? Like you have to be out of the city to be safe from a nuclear attack. Or post 9/11, you had to be out of the city, move out of the city because of the potential for a terrorist attack. And now the discussion is, well, you know, look at New York. New York was really bad, and who would want to be in the city because the rates are so high and the transmission can be so high. But then, you know, when you look at other examples, it doesn't seem to correlate. Like, is there a direct correlation of those two things or not? I started looking at these death rates versus population density, and you know, some of the most dense areas, Bangladesh, South Korea, Singapore, have some of the lowest rates of transmission of COVID in the world, where I mean, the US is about here. But it doesn't seem like there's not a kind of, you know, easy curve of the denser it is, the more rate is. And this, of course, is because there's so many factors, and these we're all just learning as we can each day about the situation. Obviously, no expert, but I was looking at this paper that is about this. So, does density aggravate the COVID-19 pandemic? And the two quotes from that I took out are effectively saying no. I mean, again, obviously there's lots of factors, but their findings suggested that connectivity matters more than density in the spread of COVID-19 pandemic. The more connected places are, either compact or sprawling, in large metropolitan areas, the harder they're hit by the pandemic. So they were looking at, I think they took 913 counties in the US. So I don't know what the equivalent is in Australia, but bigger than like several towns in a county. The problem is when there is this movement, the problem is mobility, maybe more, or commuting, tourism and moving across boundaries, rather than there being a problem inherently with density. It's the movement from, according to this study, it's the movement from one area, whether it's dense or not, to another area, to another, to another, rather than how many people live in what proximity to each other in any one area, which is interesting. Then if you zoom back out to cities, right, if you think of Tokyo, back in Tokyo, it's a polycentric city. Like, there's almost nothing really in the center. The city is composed of this series of cities around this concentric ring, like the Yamanote line, the elevated train lines, that they're almost like self-sufficient little towns or a city of villages. Ho Chi Minh City is, you know, maybe in a similar way, where there is a central business district, District 1, but each of the districts of Ho Chi Minh City really could be self-sufficient, that you could get what you need in any one of those areas without having to go to District 7 or having to go to District 1 to get that. And that's a very different model than, say, I deliberately chose these two photos because I thought they were amazingly similar to one another, Melbourne and Detroit. But Detroit is a city on a river with a single center, and the rest of it being sprawling suburbs around half of it because of the river being the other edge. But Melbourne obviously is quite similar, with a central business district surrounded by sprawling suburbs. And so you can't really get around not going into the city. You can't get around, you have to get around, I guess the other way to put it, you have to move quite a lot. And that model, at least according to some of the studies I was reading, is one in which I feel like it's liberating, because it's not putting the problem into the city and saying that the suburb is the retreat and the safe place to be. It's actually saying, well, how do we remodel cities in a more self-sufficient, polycentric way, as an example. Just in the last few minutes, I wanted to show some examples of what I think are really beautiful housing examples of Saigon, of Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam, as a way of just talking again about how domestic space could adapt in a really dense environment, while also finding ways of establishing boundaries, whether they be between the city and the house, or between landscape and the urban realm, or even between kind of commercial or public and private programs. These two examples being quite typological, I guess, is very similar, very things you see very often in the context of housing in Vietnam. This project is one that does that, I think, in such a, all of these, I guess there's only a few I'm going to show, but they all do it in a way that that somehow finds a, for me, it reminds me of the TARDIS, right? Like a building that feels bigger on the inside than on the outside. If spatially, there's a way through, in this case, the layering of these two shells, these two surfaces of one to the outside, that you create this interstitial space, which feels like it's a little bit connected, more connected to the urban context around it, but also is separating from that, like a screen. Similarly, this project by HMP Architects is taking the idea of these little narrow hems, the little narrow laneways that really are a kind of DNA of the city of Ho Chi Minh City, but thinking about it now in terms of a restaurant. So turning the inside out, taking a dense environment, but breaking it up into areas that feel like they're a bit more private or separate, but yet unified through this glass ceiling at the top of it. So you're sort of inside and outside in different ways at different times. And then similarly, this project by Atelier Toe, again, like the house inside of a house, the outside enveloping the inside, but the inside kind of spilling out into the outside space. And then finally, this project by A21, the Saigon House, which for me, the narrowness of any one of these tube houses, you know, it looks like you could only have a couple of like rooms or spaces in each level at the most. But in the interior, there's this really, I think, skillful way of trying to upend those boundaries, of make it feel like you're more connected with the outside environment. It's not just a kind of really dense, narrow tunnel. You're still connected to the space around you, but it also feels like there's more space somehow on the inside than there would look like there's on the outside. So those examples I felt like just putting in because they take the unit of the house, the sort of DNA of the house in particular in Ho Chi Minh City, and creatively rethink the ways in which boundaries are made, which I think is a relevant question for how we think about housing in the times of COVID. The last couple of minutes then, this is a resource, maybe if you haven't seen it. I've been looking through this manual of physical distancing by Lewis Samaki Lewis, or LTL Architects in New York. They put this together at Princeton with Guy Nordenson as a kind of manual. You know, they do so many beautiful diagrams. So this is a manual, it's an issue, it's on issue, it's free, just have a look. They just went through all these different respiratory analysis and spatial analysis of a single person in a space, and then also looking at different spatial types of the city. I'll just move past this one for a second because I want to show this. So they looked at these urban research territories, whether it's the street or the crosswalk, the corner, building entries, and then found ways of rethinking them for physical distancing, making again the distinction between a physical distancing and social distancing as being two very different ways of thinking about how we should be distancing ourselves in this context. This, I'll just go back, because that also was a discussion about density analysis in the city, you know, also talking about COVID rates in relationship to density and how there's not a direct correlation to that necessarily. And so I think for students that are, when you're looking at ways of thinking about urbanism and housing at the scale of urbanism, or even just housing in its own right, breaking it down into these sort of pieces of where people stand, where people move, the thresholds between inside and outside, thresholds between different rooms, thresholds between different people. I found, for me, it was an interesting way of thinking about, again, like the DNA of the house, breaking it down to these metrics of the house. There's all these different moments that could be creatively and interestingly recombined, as opposed to trying to just sort of, you know, have a frictionless environment entirely. And so these are some of the proposals bringing those different components together. So have a look at that if you haven't already. I think it's kind of interesting series of questions more than anything. And then I just, this is the last slide I wanted to end on, because we lost Michael Sorkin this year, which is just an incredible tragedy. But also in the context of talking about New York City and the scholar on New York and resident of New York. And for those of you who haven't read 20 Minutes in Manhattan, I would recommend doing so, because it takes it's basically, as in the first line of the first paragraph describes his walk, 20-minute walk from his home to his office every day, but goes systematically, again, part by part of the city, from the stairway from his house to the ground, then the walkway to the first corner. And I think there's like 10 or 12 chapters. Each one is a very discrete moment in the city and type of space in the city that he unpacks in like very interesting social, economic, political sorts of ways. And I think this quote somewhere buried in there, I can't remember which chapter, but architecture is produced at the intersection of art and property. And this is one of the many reasons it so allegedly records the history of communal life. It's that the question of communal life is really what we're up against now, right? And I think finding ways of not sort of over subscribing to a sanitized and frictionless environment, but rather finding creative ways in which those restrictions or metrics can be rethought is, you know, that's what we're here for. So I'll leave it there. Thank you so much. It's really great to be virtually in Australia again. I miss it there, and hopefully I can get there again soon. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Gretchen. That was, I think, finishing with Michael Sorkin is a really nice and fitting way to end. We've been looking at him in a minor way as well in the course that we're working on this semester. And thank you so much for such a rich articulation of I suppose the ways in which architecture mediates at different scales, from the Eames chair through to the city as a whole. I think it's really, really terrific, particularly for the students who I know are here, given that we're looking at the idea of a city within the city and what domesticity means at a whole raft of scales, as you know. And perhaps what strikes me the strongest is this master's thesis of yours, and the way in which you've elaborated these domestic configurations around ideal families, not real families, but an idea of the family, which is I think is so fascinating, that that architecture is engaging with ideas of family arrangements, which then have these urban implications, as you, I think, showed really clearly. So I thought it was a terrific and highly relevant presentation. And I know that Pia has a question, so I might throw to her.
Oh, unmute. Okay, thanks, Jesper. That was fascinating, Gretchen, as usual, an incredibly rich collection of juxtapositions in the images that really highlighted some issues. The one of Detroit and Melbourne was very striking, amongst others. And the one thing that I just wanted to raise and maybe have a very quick discussion is just that, you know, where you ended on communal life as being this question that we're having to deal with. I mean, I think we have to deal with it anyway, COVID or not. But it is already something that has been feeling urgent for some time, that we need to work this out again, because things have started sort of falling apart a little bit in many different ways in cultures. And to go back to the thing on the research that you did on COVID, and that, which was really interesting, about this issue of it being connected, the connectivity, and having to get somewhere, get places. And I was also wondering then, in the midst of that, that there's cultural issues, the communal life that we have that are around cultures, and the way that, say, for instance, like Italian families might operate very differently to English families. In the way that they operate with other families and people in the workplace, and how much they touch people, or, you know, all of that kind of thing. And I know that you've worked across you know, Vietnam and Australia and also obviously America, and you would be very well versed in sort of observing those sorts of cultural differences. And I'm just wondering a bit about that question of connectivity and cultural behavior, and whether that came into thinking about those issues at all.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why I was, it's just that question that spurred my curiosity around, like, to confusion more than anything, maybe around how the situation, you know, the situation in the US is so awful, and yet we're so bubbled, like we're so parsed out already, that there's the density in most parts that was, it's like, with the exception of the cities, we're all in our private areas, and in a place like Vietnam, you know, as you know, is all those things are just so seamlessly, constantly, not only close, like intensely, sort of intimate or in quote close proximity, but also just fluid. There, it's like there's never a moment where anything stops. You know, it's all movement all the time. So. Yeah, I mean, I think it seems like I would be sad and obviously concerned if the things that come out of this from a, say, an urban planning, urban design point of view, point to further separation, because as you say, that's the problem. But you could so easily see how that's, you know, that could become the easiest, you know, first way of pushing people out of cities through fear of, you know, communal life as being dangerous, if not deathly. So I think you're right that it's a cultural question. The question that the report that I mentioned that I showed is that was only looking at American cities. It wasn't a global one. And I think when you take that same question and put it towards, say, a Vietnamese city or even an Australian city or an Italian city, how those patterns of life will, I mean, I think in a lot of cases there already is a resistance to being too separate, right? Like you can't throw the culture out with COVID. You have to find ways of I guess managing it in a spatial way.
Well, thanks so much, Gretchen. I think just wanted to point out the fantastic attendance. There were over 100 people listening in to you. I'm not sure if you were aware of that. So, and a lot of thank yous coming through still. So it's been terrific to have you. For anyone who's tuned in, who's in an Australian time zone, remember to tune in again to the next session this evening. And we're going to look forward to having much more of Gretchen's time in our teaching later on in the semester. So, thank you very much again, Gretchen. It was really exceptional. Thank you.
Absolutely. I look forward to seeing you guys later in your semester. So terrific. Enjoy the rest of the podium, and hopefully I'll see the others after
when you wake up. Yeah. Thanks, Gretchen.
Thanks, Gretchen.
Bye.